Carr's a special friend for the department because he's a graduate of Miami University, graduated in 1976. Went on to his PhD in Indiana University, where he graduated in 1981, and spent his career, a lot of his academic career at Brown from 82 to 2008. And since that time, he's been the director of governance studies at the Brookings Institution in Washington. But, you know, it's great to have an alum back, but it's also very personal for us because Daryl's brother Gene worked in the department for a long time, and many of us knew her then. I said earlier that after I got the job here in 1992, I got a mailing, because email really wasn't used much then, from Gene asking me what my fall course book requests were. And that's when I knew, I guess this is real, I've got to get my textbooks order into Gene. So we all knew Gene. Daryl's father also was an elected official up in Crump County, from the area. His sister Shirley is with us today. We're glad she can be with us. Thanks for coming. It's just great to have you back on campus. Brian, you want to?
Yeah, so I'll be moderating our event today, and I just also want to extend a thank you to Daryl and just give you a little bit more about some of Daryl's accomplishments. He is, when we think of what we want for our Miami students and for you, his career kind of epitomizes the very best. His very distinguished career at Brown, I won't mention the years, Pat already mentioned that, but a very distinguished career there. He's published 18 books and dozens of articles, and when you think of the range of his work in terms of public policy, from immigration reform, technology innovation, education, and in terms of his contributions to the discipline of political science, in especially his work in media and politics and campaigns. It's really just an incredible honor to have him here, and now he's at Brookings, and so it's just a wonderful path that he's taken, a top-notch social scientist, and now he's at Brookings kind of illuminating public debate on the most important questions that face our time. So no further ado, Daryl.
Thank you. Thank you, Pat and Brian. It's a pleasure to be back here. I actually grew up about 10 miles from Oxford, so it's always great fun to come back. It's a good excuse for a family reunion yesterday, and my sister Shirley is here, and a childhood friend, Richard Charles, is here as well, so it's great to be back here. And it's always good to get outside of Washington, D.C. I once gave a talk, and afterwards, an older lady came up to me and said how grateful she was for the talk. So I said, so you have a better understanding of the subject matter? She said, well, frankly, no, but I'm confused at a much higher level. So I guess that's one of my goals today. You might still be confused, but I hope it's at a slightly higher level than before. It's obviously been a very tough political environment in Washington, D.C. I don't know if you heard, but in the middle of December, when the country was in the middle of the debate over the fiscal cliff, there is a big dust-up between Speaker John Boehner, who represents this part of the state, and Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid. Harry Reid had called Boehner a dictator on the floor of the Senate, and this infuriated Boehner. And in fact, it's a little bit of a joke that Reid had done that because Boehner actually has a pretty laissez-faire leadership style in the House. At Brookings, we actually think he would be a better speaker if he were a dictator and kind of ran the House from a top-down manner, but that's really not his style. And Boehner took offense at being called a dictator because he understood that Harry Reid was setting him up for political blame, that if the House was not able to deliver on the budget part of it, that he wanted Boehner to be blamed because, after all, if you're a dictator, that means you're responsible for what happens. So it so happened that President Obama decided to call the congressional leaders together at the White House to have a meeting to try and work out the negotiations. And so when Harry Reid walks in, Boehner sees him, and this is a true story, I'm not making this up, you cannot make up this thing. He flips Harry Reid the bird and says, F you. Now, Reed cannot believe this, so he says, "What did you say?" And Boehner repeated it. He flipped the bird one more time and said, "F you." Then they went in and had their meeting with Obama, and no big surprise, they weren't able to reach an agreement. So it kind of tells you a little bit about how poisonous the atmosphere has become in Washington, D.C. We have a lot of polarization, a lot of divided opinions between Republicans and Democrats. It's hard to get people to work together to try and solve a problem. So it's been a real challenge for our national political system over the last few years dealing with this. What I'd like to do today is really talk about the challenges facing President Obama and members of Congress, but I'm going to give a more optimistic view, certainly compared to what we have been through over the last few years. There's some things that are starting to change. I think some issues are going to get addressed. Obviously, there are still major divisions, I'm sure, among people here as well as people in Washington, D.C., about the right course of action. But the good news is our elected leaders are starting to come together and do some things. And so I'm going to talk about kind of the major priorities going forward in terms of rebuilding the economy, reducing the deficit, doing immigration reform, and addressing the gun issue. These are kind of the big issues that are going to be on the domestic policy agenda over the next couple years. Congress will not be able to resolve all of the issues surrounding this, but I think they are going to make some progress. We actually saw some progress on New Year's Day when Congress one day late actually chose to address the fiscal cliff issue and put some new tax provisions into effect and address some of the issues going forward. And I think when you look at the economy, the economists at Brookings are predicting that the economy is going to continue to recover. We've gone from a national unemployment rate of over 10% that is now down under 8%. Ohio is actually in better shape than the country as a whole. You're running about one percentage point lower unemployment than the country as a whole. And our economists think that when we look ahead to the next year, that national economy, that national unemployment rate is going to drop another one percentage point and then continue to drop after that. So by early next year, we're hoping to be under 7%, and this is going to have pretty profound implications for the political climate, because there obviously has been a lot of political anger across the country, a lot of anger directed against Washington, D.C., and it's no big surprise. You know, when you have terrible economic performance, when you have a lot of foreign policy challenges, when you have big deficits, you have high unemployment, people are going to be upset. A lot of people are still going to be upset going forward because they may not like some of the decisions that members of Congress make, but we're starting to see things turn, and it'll have political consequences as we move ahead in terms of the role that the Tea Party plays in national politics, the approval rating of the president, and how people see members of Congress. The budget situation is going to remain very difficult going forward. I think the crucial time point is going to come about a month from now. You may recall that members of Congress last year negotiated a budget agreement where, kind of realizing that it's difficult for them to make decisions, they basically kind of opted for a decision where if they couldn't make a decision, certain spending cuts would automatically go into effect. $1.2 trillion in budget cuts. It would be half divided between defense, which Republicans didn't like cutting that, and then half divided among domestic discretionary programs. Democrats really didn't like that. So they kind of put themselves in a situation where unless they can come to an agreement about an alternative set of spending cuts, those effects are going to automatically go into effect. And it looks like the two sides are not going to be able to agree on an alternative path. So within about a month, that trillion-dollar plus spending reduction package is going to go into effect. And although we all, I'm sure, have differing opinions over what are the particular things that we think should be cut, this is probably the best type of spending reduction that our political system can navigate right now, because it spreads the pain between defense and non-defense. It spreads the pain among some programs Republicans like and some programs the Democrats like. And so in that regard, it's a political and policy compromise that works from the standpoint of reducing the deficit. So I think people might be surprised at the fact that Congress is going to see a significant improvement in the economy. That budget deficit is starting to drop. This year's budget deficit is going to be about $800 billion. That will continue to drop over the next couple years. The goal is to get it down to 3% of gross domestic product, which tends to be a level of deficit spending that is not destabilizing for the overall economy. And we should be able to get to that point within a few years. The two issues going forward that remain very challenging will be immigration reform and addressing the gun issue. On one of these issues, immigration reform, I'm optimistic that Congress will come up with an agreement. The second issue, the gun issue, I would be shocked if Congress came up with an agreement, because there's just too wide of a range there. The immigration issue is very interesting, and I have to admit, I have a very personal stake in this issue, because 5 years ago, I married a German woman, and so I have been going through this process of getting the green card, and now we're going through the citizenship process. There have been many ups and downs along the way, and one of my interests in immigration reform was just all the problems we had in negotiating her particular citizenship. Kind of introduced me to how the process works, how completely broken our immigration reform, our immigration system is, and our need to actually reform the process. But on that particular point, I'm happy to tell you there has been a very happy ending. My wife has navigated the process, and actually tomorrow morning she gets sworn in as America's newest citizen. So we're very pleased with that. Thank you. So, but on the immigration reform issue per se, there are several points where Republicans and Democrats are pretty close to agreement, and so that part of the legislation will be easy to work out, and then there are some other parts that are going to be very challenging. But the thing that makes me optimistic that Congress will do some things on that is how the politics of immigration reform have changed, owing to the 2012 elections, because we certainly know when you look at demographic trends, the Latino population is one of America's most rapidly growing segments of the population. Latinos now number about 10% of the overall population. That number is going to grow in importance. But from a political standpoint, Latinos have even greater impact on elections because they are heavily concentrated in a few key swing states, notably Nevada, Colorado, Florida, and in a few other places. In some of those states, they comprise as much as 19% of the overall electorate. And so in the 2012 election, basically we went from a situation where George Bush in 2004 was able to win re-election and he got 44% of the Latino vote. In 2012, when Mitt Romney lost the presidential election, his share of the Latino vote had dropped down to 27%. So the reason why Republicans are now more amenable to doing some type of immigration reform is the electoral imperative is just so dramatic. In fact, a couple weeks ago, when Senator McCain and a few other leaders in the Senate came out with a bipartisan proposal on immigration reform, some enterprising reporter said, hey, Senator, you know, why are you doing this now? Like, you've spent the last few years kind of complaining about immigration policy and basically not being willing to do anything. And McCain gave the very open and honest one-word answer, which is elections. And that's really what's driving the changed environment, that both Democrats and Republicans realize that when you have a rapidly growing segment of the population, that segment is a swing vote, that it sometimes has sided with Republican presidential candidates, and in other years that percentage has dramatically dropped, that you have to go out and get those votes if you want to be competitive in following elections.